The Magic Show is brought to you by StarCityGames.com, and check this out. On Saturday, March 28th, the Star City Games $5,000 Standard Open Tournament Series comes to Indianapolis for the first time ever. And this event is going to be huge. Hundreds of players, $5,000 in cash prizes, a Pro Tour Honolulu qualifier, side events galore, and tons of fun. So make plans to join us at the SCG 5K Indianapolis, and we'll see you there.
This is Brian Greer from Deck Builders, and you're watching The Magic Show.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another edition of The Magic Show. This week, we're going to talk about extended, what was winning and what was not, this weekend's Indianapolis 5K, and live coverage of a PTQ Finals featuring Star City Games' own Sean McKeown. Let's go! Last weekend, I was in Roanoke, Virginia for not just one, but two Pro Tour qualifiers, where our own Sean McKeown will be on the show in a bit to tell us about his fairy deck complete with Ponder and battle a Naya Zoo build from Jimmy Rogers. With that said, there are just a few more weeks of PTQs left. What is the right choice and what was rocking the top tables? Well, a few things. First, Elf Combo is really, really scary. Its ability to nullify sideboard cards like Pyrostatic Pillar by merely playing a Court of Calling for Burns and Forge Tender and going off anyway is just nuts. And how about Court of Calling a Mirror Entity instead and beating you to death with Insect Tokens and Llanowar Elves pumped to ridiculous sizes? Either works great, and while it's incredibly difficult to play well, it's incredibly difficult to beat when piloted by a skilled player. Also, when I lost to a Teps deck that beat me on turn 2, I was fully reminded of how incredibly powerful a mixture of library manipulation, mana production, mana filtering, and one big nasty storm spell can be. Again, difficult to pilot, but for those who are good at math, putting the pieces together and are a little lucky, these are the decks to wield. All I know is, this weekend I not only got a good look at the power of Naya Zoo close up, specifically the interaction that Woolly Thoktar cannot be enchanted with Threads of Disloyalty, which is huge, I also got a chance to get a good look at top 8s all over the world. And I think there's some really interesting and deeply hidden tech found there. First up, the card that is defining Standard even more so than Cryptic Command or Bitter Blossom right now, Revelark. This guy is going to see a ton of play over the years, so get used to him. Now he's hit Extended and some of the interactions are just nasty. How about Eternal Witness and Moloku the Clouded Mirror? Man, returning Moloku to play with a Revelark has to be the sickest thing I've seen since watching Jackass 2. Plus, Eternal Witness to return the Revelark back to your hand? Oh man, stop it, you're making me nauseous. Another deck that has snuck up quietly in a few top 8s overseas is Perrin's Aggro. This is the deck that utilizes the once quite crappy but now quite powerful Dissension Rare Pillar of the Perrins to play any spell in the deck. This one takes the aggro approach with Noble Hierarch and Rox Warmonk along with your negates fully upgraded to counter squalls. Lightning Helix and Lightning Angel join the party giving you hasty damage and life gain to boot. What I see here is not a perfect deck list. Instead, I see a huge area of potential. There are simply hundreds of gold and hybrid cards to choose from these days, and Pillar of the Perrin seems ripe for abuse. The problem, of course, is living through Blood Moon, as my buddy Patrick Chapin pointed out, but hey, what's a silver bullet here and there for a deck with a lot of potential? Either way, this extended season has been incredibly diverse and healthy despite the fears of Elf Combo taking over the metagame after Pro Tour Berlin. Speaking of PTQs, you'll find one this weekend at the Star City Games 5K in Indianapolis on Sunday, following the standard action tomorrow. Better yet, there's one of the first Magic Cruise qualifiers there happening Saturday afternoon with the champ getting a full ride, so to speak, to the cruise. It's a hell of a good time to be a Magic player. Lastly, before we move on to the extended footage, Wizards of the Coast announced Zendikar this week, the name for the first set of the new block coming this fall. The logo and the phrase, Deadly Perils, Priceless Treasures. Now, much speculation has been spurred on by these four words, this tagline for the set, as it were, and I think that's great. Set taglines have only been used since Shards of Alara, and they drive both interest and guessing in regards to what Zendikar will actually be about. My guess is this will either be a Mayan/Aztec world, or, what I'm really hoping for, a prehistoric world filled with dinosaurs and such. Yeah, Imperiosaur, here we come! More on this new set as we get details. So with no further ado, let's take a look at the PTQ Finals in Roanoke. This was filmed at the first PTQ on Saturday evening.
Hi, I'm Sean McKeown. I'm from Long Island, New York, and I've been playing Magic since Homelands. What an embarrassing set to start on.
My name's Jimmy Rogers. I'm from Hampton, Virginia, and started playing when Scourge came out.
I'm playing Fairies, because if I can't play a blue deck, I'm probably staying home that day.
All right, so tell me about the Ponder, because you have this special
Because
Ponder
everyone's
deck.
Going to ask about it.
Right.
I just found out that Ponder, next to Ancestral Visions, is really good. No, really good. So I'm playing. I started with the Japanese Fairies list from Worlds, found four cards I didn't like, and put them in instead. So I cut the Azami Lady of Scrolls that has since become Future Sight, because really, it's just better. And I'm gaming without Stifle today.
No Stifle, and you beat Storm.
Round 7, I did in fact beat a Storm combo deck with no Stifles in my deck.
That's fantastic.
Beat him 2-0.
I am playing the Naya version of Zoo, and it's because Kenny Mayer took fourth, and he's a good friend of mine, and I like the build. It's aggressive, it's in there.
So tell me, what is your strategy going into the finals?
It's not the best matchup, which is really funny because I was just talking about this in my article last week, that Naya Zoo has a really hard time closing in the finals. I'm playing Fairies versus Naya Zoo. The key thing is, Engineered Explosives is very important. I play 3 in the main and 4 Ponders. I'm going to see them a little bit more often early. I've got the 4th in the sideboard, I've still got 4 Ponders, so I can stop him from dealing damage in the early game, and if I can do that, I can probably win.
In Game 1, Sean wins the roll and keeps a hand of Sower of Temptation, Mutavault, Snow-Covered Island, Secluded Glen, Spellstutter Sprite, Mana Leak, and Vendilion Click. Jimmy mulligans a hand of Char, Keldon Marauders, 2 Wild Nacatls, Incinerate, Mog Fanatic, and Mountain. Jimmy keeps his 6-card hand consisting of Mountain, 2 Mog Fanatics, Windswept Teeth, Stomping Ground, and Sacred Foundry. Sean gets things started with a tap Secluded Glen, while Jimmy leads with a Mountain and Mog Fanatic. Sean plays Mutavault and says go, while Jimmy attacks with Mog Fanatic, taking Sean to 19. Jimmy then plays and immediately uses Windswept Teeth, going to 19, getting a Forest and playing Keldon Marauders right into Sean's Mana Leak. For Sean's turn, he once again plays Land, go. Jimmy, meanwhile, attacks Sean to 18. He plays and uses Wooded Foothills and plays a Mog Fanatic. Sean responds with Spellstutter Sprite, leading Jimmy to kill the Spellstutter with the in-play Mog Fanatic, then plays another one after that. Sean plays Draw, go. Jimmy attacks as Sean plays Vendilion Click in response, seeing Jimmy's exciting hand of Sacred Foundry and Stomping Ground. Vendilion Click blocks one of the Mog Fanatics, which deals 1 to Sean after damage is put on the stack, taking him to 16. Sean suspends an Ancestral Visions and passes. Jimmy uses a Bloodstained Mire, going down to 17. On Jimmy's turn, he attacks, taking Sean to 15 and passes. Sean, meanwhile, plays Sower of Temptation, targeting Mog Fanatic. Jimmy sacks it in response to take Sean to 14. On Jimmy's turn, he rips and plays Woolly Thoctar and passes. Sean attacks with Sower of Temptation, taking Jimmy to 15 and plays another, targeting Woolly Thoctar. Jimmy merely plays another Mog Fanatic and passes. Sean plays Secluded Glen, revealing Vendilion Click. He then attacks with everything as Jimmy blocks the Thoctar and deals 1 to Sean with damage on the stack from Mog Fanatic. Jimmy goes down to 11 while Sean is comfortably at 13. During Jimmy's draw step, Sean plays Vendilion Click to see Bloodstained Mire and Tarmogoyf, putting the overpowered 2-mana creature on the bottom of his library. Jimmy then draws and plays a Char, targeting the Sower of Temptation controlling Woolly Thoctar, but Sean has the Spellstutter Sprite to counter it, and we're on to Game 2. For sideboarding, Jimmy removes 4 Keldon Marauders and 2 Mog Fanatic, while bringing in 2 Umezawa Jitte and 4 Duragar Hedgemage. Sean takes out Ponder, Moloku the Clouded Mirror, an Ancestral Vision, and Vendilion Click for 3 Threads of Disloyalty and 1 more Engineered Explosives. For Game 2, Jimmy is on the play and keeps a hand of Lightning Helix, Mog Fanatic, Tarmogoyf, Sacred Foundry, Wooded Foothills, Incinerate, and Windswept Heath. Sean mulligans a hand of Riptide Laboratory, Mutavault, Two Secluded Glen, Snow-Covered Island, Umazawa Jite, and Threads of Disloyalty. He keeps his six-carder of Secluded Glen, Flooded Strand, Umazawa Jite, Ponder, Spell Snare, and Polluted Delta. Jimmy begins by playing Wooded Foothills and going to 19 life, fetching a mountain for Mog Fanatic. Sean begins by playing and sacrificing Flooded Strand, going to 19, gets an island, and passes. Jimmy attacks Sean to 18, plays a Windswept Heath, uses it to find an untapped Stomping Ground, going down to 16 life, and Jimmy's Tarmogoyf runs smack into Sean's Spell Snare. Sean simply plays another island and says go. Jimmy attacks with Mog Fanatic, plays Windswept Heath, and passes. Sean plays Ponder on his turn, lays Polluted Delta, and passes. Jimmy fetches at the end of Sean's turn, going down to 15. Jimmy then attacks with Mog Fanatic, taking Sean to 16, plays Sacred Foundry, and passes. Sean uses the Polluted Delta at the end of his turn, going to 15. Sean on his turn plays Ponder, then Mutavault, and passes. Jimmy attacks Sean to 14 and plays Woolly Thoctar, which runs into a mana leak. Sean uses his Polluted Delta at the end of his turn, going to 13. Sean plays another turn of Draw Go. Jimmy, meanwhile, sacrifices Bloodstained Mire at the end of Sean's turn, going down to 14 as well. Sean plays a Vendilion Click, to which Jimmy responds with a Lightning Helix to it, bringing the life totals to 17 and 13 in Jimmy's favor. Click takes the Char from Jimmy's hand as Jimmy attacks Sean to 12. Sean suspends an Ancestral Visions and passes while Jimmy goes to 16 from sacrificing Wooded Foothills at the end of Sean's turn. Jimmy attacks, taking Sean to 11 and plays a Wild Nacatl. Sean, meanwhile, plays a Jite on his turn and passes. On the following turn, Jimmy attacks Sean to 7 and successfully resolves Sulfuric Vortex. Going to 5 from Vortex, Sean plays a Glenalindra Archmage and passes. Jimmy is down to 14 on his turn from Vortex, plays Incinerate targeting the Archmage, who returns thanks to Persist, and after another attack, Sean is down to 2 life, who scoops it up before Sulfuric Vortex can finish him off. In Game 3, Sean removes 2 Umazawa Jites for a Glenalindra Archmage and Ponder. As for their openers, Sean is on the play and keeps a hand of Threads of Disloyalty, Vendilion Click, 2 Snow-Covered Island, Glenalindra Archmage, Ponder, and Mana Leak. Jimmy, meanwhile, keeps a hand of Woolly Thoctar, Incinerate, Bloodstained Mire, Windswept Heath, Seal of Fire, Tarmogoyf, and Umazawa Jite. Sean starts off with Island and Ponder before passing the turn. Jimmy sacrifices a Bloodstained Mire to find an untapped Stomping Ground going to 17 and playing a fully powered Curdape. Sean simply plays Mutavault and passes. Jimmy sacrifices Windswept Heath and goes to 14 for an untapped Sacred Foundry. He attacks with Curdape and runs his Umazawa Jite directly into Sean's Mana Leak before passing. Sean plays another island and passes. Jimmy, meanwhile, attacks Sean to 16 and plays Woolly Thoctar, which resolves. Sean plays Vendilion Click at the end of his turn, and Jimmy shows Umazawa Jite, Tarmogoyf, Incinerate, and Seal of Fire. Sean chooses to put the Jite on the bottom. For his next turn, Sean simply plays Flooded Strand and passes. On his next turn, Jimmy plays Seal of Fire, and Sean has the Spellstutter Sprite. Jimmy then incinerates the Vendilion Click and attacks Sean to 9 life. At the end of Jimmy's turn, Sean sacrifices his Flooded Strand, going to 8. Sean plays another turn of Draw Go. Jimmy attacks with Curdape and Woolly Thoctar, and Sean activates both of his Mutavaults. Before blockers, Jimmy decides to incinerate a Mutavault, allowing Sean to chump block the Woolly Thoctar with Spellstutter Sprite and take 2 from the Curdape, going to 6. Jimmy plays another Curdape and passes. Sean uses his Polluted Delta, falling to just 5 life, and plays Threads of Disloyalty on one of the Curdapes. Jimmy, meanwhile, turns him sideways, and Sean blocks Woolly Thoctar with Curdape, going to just 3 life. Tarmogoyf, meanwhile, runs into Spell Snare, but a Wooded Foothills into Temple Garden, takes Jimmy to 11 and allows him to play a second Tarmogoyf from his hand, which prompts the concession. Jimmy Rogers is your Honolulu PTQ champion.
All right, Jimmy. Give me the best. I'm going to Hawaii.
Woo! No, no. I'm all this man! Hawaii!
I have to celebrate you, baby. I have to praise you like I should.
I always like the fatties.
I'm sweating.
Oh, Mike, Mike, you gotta swim through the scrubs.
Swim.